now for the Yankee baseball game, so let's go down and pick up the starting lineup.
For the Yankees, Bobby Richardson leads off, second base. Tony Kubek, shortstop. Roger Maris, center field.
Roger Maris hit his 61st home run on October 1st, 1961. I was at home watching the game on television in New York. And right after the game was over, I wrote a letter to WPIX, the television station that was broadcasting the game. And I requested of them if I could get a videotape of that historic moment in baseball. Now, keep in mind, that was the first year that WPIX was using videotape. And it would be years before videotape got to the general public. And even if WPIX had sent me a videotape, which was about 3 inches in width, I had no machine to play it on. In fact, the machine was the size of a piano and it cost tens of thousands of dollars. But patience and persistence paid off. A couple of years ago, I was able to get that video. What you are about to see is the actual TV telecast of that historic moment in baseball. Red Barber was doing the play-by-play for the Yankees along with Mel Allen. This video has not been seen in over 50 years.
Fastball is wide. He lays off of it. Ball one. Low. Ball two. The crowd is reacting negatively. They want to see Maris get something he can swing on. There it is. $5,000, somebody. He got his pitch. Look, $5,000. And here is the fellow with 61. You're seeing a lot today.
I was 13 years old when that happened, and I thought something like that only happens once in somebody's lifetime. And I started to think, I wonder what the 50th anniversary of that home run is going to be like. And then I also started to think, I wonder what my life is going to be like in 50 years. So, last October, on the 50th anniversary of that home run, at the age of 63, I traveled back to New York. I went to the footprint of old Yankee Stadium. You see, they had knocked it down a couple of years earlier. I went with a friend, and we arrived just before 2:43 in the afternoon, which was the exact moment that Maris connected. In memory of that historic moment, I took out my iPhone, and just as it clicked over to 2:43, I played Phil Rizzuto's radio broadcast.
On Roger Maris. Here's the windup. Fastball hit deep to right. It's going to be it. Way back there. Holy cow.
Silly, sentimental, and obsessed with baseball. Everything was different after 50 years, and yet everything was the same. That's baseball.
speeding bullets.
As a kid growing up, I made a wish list of those things that I wanted. Now, keep in mind, I was only a kid, but I wanted to get my name in the Weekly Reader newspaper. I wanted to fly like Superman, own a Roy Rogers chuck wagon, have sideburns like Elvis, own a real Babe Ruth baseball card, visit every state, meet Roger Maris, live in California, see a ball game in every major league park, work for a baseball team, attend the World Series and All-Star games, and if I were to ever get married, I wanted to get married at home plate. Well, as it turned out, I got to achieve them all. Well, everything except for flying like Superman.
Hey, boy, take that ball out of your mouth. Haven't you ever seen a baseball before? Haven't you ever played baseball?
There's something kind of about a kid that's never played baseball.
You're unbelievable. You're so unbelievable. You're unbelievable.
There goes a screaming liner into left field.
Unbelievable.
I would feel more comfortable if we had a, you know, a sign, you know, just.
You do that in front of the client, he's either going to fire me or steal second.
He's stealing second!
No, 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 stop it!
A brouhaha breaks out between the guys in the camp, you know, and the old Yankee players. And as I'm trying to get Moose Scaron off of one of my teammates, you know, somebody pulls me from behind, you know, and I turned around and I popped him. I looked down and, whoa, man, it's Mickey.
Having a cup of coffee.
And he's dunking.
Yeah. Look at him. The Yankee Clipper.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah, I don't believe it. It's really you, the Capital City Goofball.
Wait, Boggs, huh? Yeah, how you doing? I'm Babe Ruth. I'm his good friend, Dizzy Dean.
That shooter's Joe Jackson.
Of course it is.
This is ridiculous. I'm an athlete, not an actor.
The guy's a baseball player, Jerry. Baseball.
Give it to him.
That's the old pepper boy. That's the old pitching. That's putting it over the old plate boy.
You got it. One more thing. One more. You got it.
Get out. Hey, out.
Hey, out. Hey, out.
Safe.
Out.
Safe.
Out. Safe. Out.
So do you hate baseball?
No, I like baseball. I just never understood how you guys can spend so much time discussing it.
And I'm not asking you who's on second or third.
I don't know. Third base.
I mean, I've been to games, but I don't memorize who played third base for Pittsburgh in 1960.
Don Hoke. Beat you.
Who I'm trying to find out is what's the guy's name on first base?
No, one is on second base.
I'm not asking you.
This is funny, Ray. Don't you think this is funny?
Yes,
this is
funny.
Are you crying? Are you crying? There's no crying. There's no crying in baseball!
High over right field, that ball is still going! It's way back! High up in the air!
What is it about baseball that it has managed to ingrain itself into the fabric of American life? Jacques Barzon, famous American historian, wrote about baseball in 1954 and its relationship to America. He wrote, "Whoever wants to know the heart and mind of America had better learn baseball." So why has it taken on such significant importance? And why would a kid from the Bronx or Oskaloosa, Iowa, or Del Mar or Santee become so enamored with the game of baseball? Could it possibly be because baseball ties meaning and rituals to numbers? Let me throw some baseball numbers out at you. 56, 61, 406, 511, 714, 755, 2,130. My first experience with baseball took place in a small Jewish camp in the Pennsylvania Poconos Mountains. They called it a sleepaway camp. Now, my folks later on would explain to me that the reason why they sent me to camp is because they didn't want me on the streets of the Bronx during the summer. So, at a very early age, I was sent to camp. Sleepaway camp. For 2 months. July and August. I was 3 years old.
Hello, mother. Hello, father. Here I am at Camp Granada. Camp is very...
Camp was a series of learning lessons for me. I switched from Gerber's baby food to regular food. I took showers instead of being bathed in the kitchen sink. And I wore grown-up pajamas, you know, the ones without the feet attached. And I experienced baseball. Oh, did I? I owned my first baseball glove, had a catch, and I was on a baseball team. But the most important thing that I learned at camp was about girls. Now, I did have a girlfriend in the Bronx. Her name was Sharon. She lived on the fourth floor, same apartment building as me. Let me tell you, she was a babe, a real babe. No, really, she was. And that's what the problem was. You see, I was 3 years old, and Sharon was 24, 25 months old. I was looking for someone a little bit more mature. So the following summer at camp, when I'm 4 years old, I started seeing an older woman. Her name was Esther Saflis, and she was 9 years old. Yeah, I know about the age difference thing. Esther was going into fourth grade. I hadn't started school. And she was a little bit taller than me. All right, maybe she was a foot taller than me. But what a body. Incredible. Perfect. 24, 24, 24. Maybe 25, 24, 25. But she was gorgeous. She was the hit of every Saturday social dance. All eyes were on her. Well, it was at camp I also learned about the breakup. She finds out that I think we're boyfriend and girlfriend. She comes to me at a Saturday social dance and she says, "Andy, I think it's time that we start seeing other children." I was crushed, but I quickly got over it. I think it took me about 15 minutes. Then she came to me and she said, "I suggest that you start seeing somebody closer to your own age." Unfortunately, Esther was the youngest girl at camp. I grew up a mama's boy, and I'm proud of it. In fact, it was at camp that I found out that my name was Andrew and not Bubble Boy, which is what my mother always referred to me as. Being separated from my mother caused me a lot of stress, which unfortunately settled in my stomach. And once I started school, well, it seemed like every day I was going to the school nurse complaining about a stomach ache. Now, the school nurse at PS 105, she'd have to call my mother, who would come and pick me up, And then we would walk home. And it was about 9 blocks to my apartment building. About halfway on the way home, my stomachache actually went away. And on the way home, we stopped and bought packs of baseball cards. Yep, that's where the baseball card thing started for me. My mother realized very quickly that my formal education was not going to be completed at the rate of 45 minutes a day. So she came up with a plan, a very clever plan. She gave me one of her pearl earrings, and she told me to hold on to it. And she said, the next time that I get a stomachache, all I have to do is to touch her pearl earring, and my stomachache would go away. So the next day at school, I put it in my pocket. Around 9:30, my stomach starts bothering me. I slowly reach in, I touch her pearl earring. My stomachache went away. I couldn't believe it, it worked. Well, it kept on working, day after day after day. But after about 2 or 3 weeks, my stomachache didn't go away as fast as it had previously. So I went to my mom and I asked her, is it at all possible that the magic healing powers by touching your pearl earring is starting to wear off? And my mother said, Vel, Shanela, baby, booby boy, love of my life, Andrew. Yes, that is possible. She then explained to me all I had to do was just go to her dresser and pick up one of her items and use that. So I went to her dresser and I got, you know, the gloves that women wore back in the 1950s, the white ones, the long white ones. I got one of those and I put that in my pocket and that started to work. But that also stopped working after about a couple of weeks. So I went to my mom one more time and I asked her, can I have something new? And she finally said, look, you don't have to ask me. All you have to do is just go and get a fresh item. Whatever you want is fine by me. Well, I kept going back time after time. 8 months later, it's the spring of my first year at PS 105. There's a PA announcement from Mrs. Halloran, our principal. She has asked for all the students to go down to the gymnasium. So there we are, 5-year-olds, filing 2 by 2 down the stairs to the gymnasium. Once we get there, we're instructed to form a circle by holding our neighbor's hand and then dropping them. Within a few minutes, here comes Mrs. Halloran. She walks into the middle of the circle and says, people, we have a problem here at PS 105. Somebody is taking somebody else's property, and I'm going to catch the thief right now. When I point to you, I want you to turn your pockets inside out. Well, now my stomach is really bothering me. Although I'm not taking anybody else's property, I knew it would appear that way because I never returned any of my mother's things. Mrs. Halloran points to me. I start sobbing, then crying. I reach into my pockets and slowly turn them inside out. And out comes her necklace, her earrings, her gloves, her glasses, 2 pins. The teachers must have thought they caught the infamous cat burglar. I was so embarrassed, I ran screaming to the boys' room and locked myself in a stall. Folks, it is 100% true. I was a mama's boy. But I was proud of it. It was my father, Sidney Israel Strasberg, who introduced me to baseball. After he passed away, I found a bunch of his diaries, and I decided to take a look at the year that I was born, 1948, and the day, July 17th, which also happens to be the day that it was reported that Leo DeRocher went from the Dodgers to manage the Giants. Anyway, I look at the diary and I read the page, and the page is all filled with information about DeRocher. My dad gets to the last line and he leaves it for me. Helene had a baby boy and we named him Andrew. My dad took me in my first baseball game, and I didn't realize it at the time that it was going to be life-changing. I remember walking through the streets of Harlem. It was 1957. And we came across this humongous big building. It was the Polo Grounds. We walked in and we came out from this dark tunnel to this wide open field of green, green grass. I have never been able to describe the color of the grass with only one green. My dad had bought general admission tickets. We're sitting in the upper deck behind home plate. Around the third inning, my dad says, "You wait here, I'll be right back." I'm figuring he's going to buy me a souvenir. Within a few minutes, he's at the bottom of the section and he's trying to get my attention. Finally, I see him and now he starts motioning for me to come down. I'm thinking, it's the fourth inning and we're going home? I slowly and carefully walk down the steep steps and I grab my dad's hand. The next thing I know is we're walking behind the seats on the third base side. We get to the field level and we are right at third base box seats. My dad tips the usher. And that's it. We are sitting in box seats. I'm 20 feet from the field. My heart is pounding. My senses are in overload. Sight, sound, smell, even the taste of a hot dog. This is it. This is where it all began. This is where it started. This is where I fell in love with the game of baseball. This is where I became obsessed with the game of baseball. I read about it. I listened to it. I watched it. I played it. I collected it. I even dreamt about it. It got so bad that my mom was concerned for my well-being. You remember that great line about Jacques Barzon and that he came up with in 1954? Well, my mom came up with a great line about baseball. It was 1960. If Andrew only knew his schoolwork as well as he knows baseball, because baseball's not going to help him later on in life. If only my mom had lived long enough to know that for 22 years, I worked for the San Diego Padres.
And now, here come the Padres.
Working for the Padres in the 1970s was not easy. We didn't have a great team back then. And you know what? Excuse me for a second, but I was working in the front office, and all you fans, you don't think we heard what you were saying about the team back then? You wanted us to change the name from the San Diego Padres to the San Diego Possums because we play dead at home and get killed on the road. It wasn't funny then, and it's not funny now. Maybe now it is funny. Maybe now it is relevant. Nobody loved my job more than my dad. You know how parents, when they come and they visit their kids, they stay for a week, 10 days, maybe 2 weeks? Not my dad. My dad would come out and visit during the baseball season for 1 month. I'd get up early in the morning telling him I'm going to the ballpark, and my dad would say, "I'll get to the ballpark and meet up with you about 3:30-ish. Well, he did come to the ballpark around 3:30, but he never came to my office. My dad went straight down onto the field. He went into the dugout. He went into the clubhouse. He visited with the players, the manager, the coaches, the trainer, the traveling secretary. I mean, my dad just became a social butterfly. Fortunately for me, my dad had the good sense, just before the game started, to come up to my seats at third base. Now, the most curious part of every visit that my dad made is that when he came out from New York to California, he never changed his watch to California time. He always kept it on New York time, which presented some challenges. There would be times that we'd have to coordinate our schedules, and I would say a time, and my dad, now he had to do the math. He looked at his watch on his left wrist and then started counting backwards with his right hand extending his fingers in order to figure out what time we were going to meet. 1985, opening day. My dad's out for a visit. We are going to commemorate and honor that 1984 Padres season. Now, for some of you who may not know, that was the first year that the Padres won the pennant. It was 1984. And we were going to have a big ceremony, and I wanted to get my dad something very special. In fact, I don't know if many of you remember, but in 1984, when the Padres won the pennant, they beat the Chicago Cubs. And we had a special song that we played. It was the Ghostbusters song, but we changed it to Cubbusters. Does anybody remember that? I get goosebumps every time I hear that song. Well, I go down to the Padres gift shop. I'm looking for something special for my dad. Fortunately for me, they had a 1984's Padre commemorative watch. I gave it to my dad, and he was thrilled. He loved it. He wore it all the time. He was so proud of it. A couple of years later, it's after the 1987 season. My wife, Patty, and I have decided that we're going to take our vacation in New England. And what we planned on doing was flying to New York, rent a car, have dinner with my dad, and then drive to Vermont. Well, plane lands at JFK. I get off the plane, and I hear, "Andy Strasberg, please pick up a white courtesy telephone. Andy Strasberg, white courtesy telephone." I go over, I answer the phone, and it's my sister. She's on the other end, and she's crying. And she tells me that our dad had passed away from a massive heart attack an hour before my plane had landed. I can't believe it. I had spoken to him the day before, and he was absolutely fine. And now he's gone. Well, for the next 2 days, all I did was work on his funeral and his burial. I go to the funeral home with the suit that my dad's going to be buried in. And while I'm there, the funeral home director gives me a manila envelope with my dad's personal effects. I slowly walk into the parking lot. I sit in my rented car, and I open it up, and I look inside, and I can't believe these things. His wallet, his cash, his glasses, his keys, his ring, loose change, his 1984 Padres watch. I had an idea. I went back into the funeral home, and I asked the funeral home director if it would be possible for my dad to be buried with his wristwatch. The funeral home director said, "Yes, absolutely. We will do it." Burying my dad with his 1984 Padres pennant-winning watch was absolutely, positively the right thing to do. But I did change the watch to California time. So you're probably wondering, where did this whole idea about working in baseball begin? Well, I found out at a very early age that I was never going to be good enough to be a baseball player. I decided I wanted to work in the front office of a baseball team. And I thought that the entry-level position for me would be as a ball boy, which is a step below a bat boy. I wrote a letter to the Yankees. I was 12 years old, requesting the opportunity for an interview for the position of ball boy. The Yankees sent me back a form letter. They said, "Thank you for your interest. You have to be 18 years old in order to apply." I knew that. That was part of the plan. I sent a letter to the Yankees 6 years in a row. I am convinced that the second year my letter showed up, the same secretary was opening that letter. She recognized my name, and then held the letter up and said to the other secretaries in the Yankee office, "Hey ladies, guess who's looking for that job for the ball boy position for the New York Yankees?" And then they all said, you know, like the 1940 musicals, they all sang my name, "Andy Strasberg." Well, I became 18 and I got the letter that I was looking for. It had the date and the time of the interview. Now, back then, there was no such thing as instant printing. If you wanted something printed, you had to actually go to a printer. They'd set the type. And if you wanted a logo, Well, they'd have to handcraft the logo. I had an idea of a very special business card that I wanted made. The printer told me that it would take 2 weeks and it would be very expensive. I said, fine. Now it's the day of my interview. I walk in to Yankee Stadium and I'm wearing my bar mitzvah suit. Not really, I'm actually wearing the suit after my bar mitzvah suit. But everybody in my family always called it my bar mitzvah suit. In fact, everybody in my family called every suit I wore until I was about 35 my bar mitzvah suit. I go in and I see the receptionist and I tell her who I am and what I'm here for. Next thing I know, Bill Ackerman of the Yankees comes out to escort me back to his office for the interview. At that moment, I hand him my special secret custom-made business card. He looks at it and he goes, "What the hell is this?" And I said, "Mr. Ackerman, that will be a valid business card at the conclusion of this interview." 45 minutes later, I got the job. Bill Ackerman takes me down to the Yankee clubhouse and introduces me to Peachy, the Yankee clubhouse equipment manager. Sheehy gives me my Yankee cap, and I'm thinking, my baseball career has begun. Ackerman tells me to call Yankee Stadium sometime in March. I call Yankee Stadium on March 1st. Ackerman wanted me to come in for orientation, sign some papers, and also get fitted for a uniform. When the switchboard operator answers, I tell her who I am and I ask for Bill Ackerman. The next voice that I heard, and I will never ever forget this name, was Colonel Stallings. He gets on the phone and he says, Colonel Stallings here, how can I help you? I explained who I was. I explained that Bill Ackerman hired me and I am the new Yankee ball boy for the upcoming season. And Colonel Stallings says, new ownership. Ackerman doesn't work here anymore, and neither do you. Well, I was pretty upset. I was pretty mad. Believe it or not, I tracked Bill Ackerman down into his home. I got him on the phone, and I started yelling at him. You have no idea how important this is to me. What are you going to do about it? You promised me. Bill Ackerman says, Hold on a minute, Andy. Let me ask you a couple of questions. Do you live with your parents? Yes, I live with my parents. He then said, do you pay rent? I said, no, I don't pay rent. He said, Andy, what are your financial responsibilities? Well, at this point, I had no idea where he was going with the questioning. And I explained to them, after my insurance, my gas money, the money that I use for friends and going out, I said, I guess I don't have any other financial responsibilities. And Ackerman said, Andy, I've got a daughter in college. I've got one who's about to go to college. I've got a mortgage on a home, and I'm paying on 2 car loans, and I don't have a job. Oh, I understand. I get it. I apologized. I said I was sorry, and I said, I hope someday, Mr. Ackerman, you get a job in baseball. And he said to me, Andy, someday I hope you get a job in baseball too. 1975, my first year working for the San Diego Padres, I had checked to see if Ackerman was working in baseball, and he had gotten a job in baseball. And one day, during the 1975 season, I heard that he was up in the press box. So I had decided to find Ackerman and reintroduce myself. So I go up, and as soon as I spot him, I said, excuse me, Mr. Ackerman, my name is Andy Strasberg, and 9 years ago, you probably don't remember me, but 9 years ago, you interviewed me, and he looked at me and he goes, oh, I remember you, Andy. We had dinner that night in the press box, we laughed, we told a bunch of stories, and we finished the evening about how we both had survived.
We're talking Tigers, talking number one. We're talking about a team whose time has come. We've led the pennant race from wire to wire.
So, I'm going to bring you back to 1984 again, and just to remind you, that playoff situation with the Cubs, it was the best 3 out of 5, and the first 2 games, we got beat up pretty bad in Chicago. Now we're coming back to play what might have been the third and last playoff game. Well, during the 22 years that I worked for the Padres, my responsibilities included marketing and staging special events. So I was in charge of the ceremonial first pitch, and Joan Kroc, our owner, was scheduled to throw out that first pitch. She called me up that morning, and she had an idea that she wanted to share with me. She said, "Andy, I'm scheduled to throw out the ceremonial first pitch tonight. What would you think if I wore a full Padres uniform and surprise everybody?" Well, Mrs. Kroc is the last person that you would ever think would wear a baseball uniform. I mean, she's a millionaire plus, and yet she got caught up in all the excitement of the first ever postseason for the Padres. She then continued, she said, "This is what I'll do. I'll wear a long overcoat to hide the uniform." "Wow, Mrs. Kroc, that is a great idea." She said, "Why don't you go and get me a uniform, something that fits, and bring it to my office?" Naturally, I said to her, "Mrs. Kroc, what's your size?" She said, 34B. Anyway, I went down to the equipment manager and I asked for a bat boy uniform. And while I was down there, I came up with an idea for the back of the uniform to put the letters and numbers so it spelled out J period KROC and the number 84. So I got everything and I went to her office and I presented her with the uniform. She started to get undressed immediately in front of me. I didn't know what to do with my eyes. Do I look at her eyes? Do I look up in the corner of the room? Finally, she realized I was a little bit uncomfortable. She said, "Andy, why don't you turn around?" So I did. She finished getting dressed, and she said, "Okay, take a look." Well, she looked spectacular. This was going to work, and in a very big way. She told me to get the women that worked for her in her office, bring them in. I did, and Mrs. Kroc loved the reception that she was getting. Well, now it's my turn to shine. I said, "Mrs. Kroc, to add to your great idea, here is my suggestion." Now, we're all around this small conference table, and I say, "For the back of the uniform, I suggest that we put on the following letters and numbers." And slowly, with a great deal of ceremony, I laid down on that conference table J period KROC and the number 84. Mrs. Kroc looked at me and she said, "Oh, Andy, I can always count on you to make an idea better." She then turned to one of the women that works for her and said, "You're going to have to call my seamstress. I need it tightened here, take it in here, and don't forget all the letters and the numbers." Well, in all the confusion, Mrs. Kroc left one item on the conference table. I picked it up, I put it in the palm of my hand, and I extended it to her from across the table, and I said, "Mrs. Kroc, you missed your period." The only thing that you could hear was me sweating. The women in the room stopped breathing. I didn't know what to say. Somebody had to say something, anything, but it couldn't be me because I just didn't know what to say. Finally, Mrs. Kroc broke the silence, looked at me with a little bit of a smile on her face and said, "Sweetie, you've got nothing to worry about. I haven't had a period in 15 years. Growing up in the 1950s in New York, all my friends loved baseball. And without exception, their favorite baseball player was Mickey Mantle, or Moishe Mandel, as my father used to call him. I didn't like Mickey Mantle. I mean, he was a great player, but he wasn't the guy that I was looking for. I was looking for somebody else, somebody different. Mantle just didn't do it for me. After the 1959 season, the Yankees traded for an outfielder from Kansas City, and his name was Roger Maris. There was this great article in Sport Magazine. It's titled, Roger Maris Rejuvenates the Yankees. Now, I'm embarrassed to tell you that at 12 years old, I had no idea what the word rejuvenated meant. So I looked it up and I thought, how is it possible that one player can make another team youthful and full of energy and vigor? But Maris did. He actually helped the Yankees win the pennant in 1960. I followed Maris pretty closely that summer, and I saw that there were a number of different labels identifying him. Now, I'm 12 years old, and I'm sure that these names that they had used had been used many times before, but I was the perfect age, and they resonated with me. They talked about Roger Maris being an unselfish player, being a team player, and they also used the words that he was a family man. And I thought, that's pretty interesting. Well, 1961. Greatest summer of my youth. That was the summer that Roger Maris and Mickey Mantle challenged Babe Ruth's single season home run mark of 60. It seemed like every day, or at least every other day, either Mantle or Maris would hit a home run. 1961, the summer, I was going to be bar mitzvahed, and I was studying for my bar mitzvah. In fact, my bar mitzvah was September 9th, 1961. I remember on that day, the only thing that I could think about was my Torah portion and Roger Maris. After my bar mitzvah service, I was in Rabbi Schwartz's office, and he says to me, Andy, today you are a man. You can make your own decisions. Are you going to continue your Hebrew studies? Well, before I answered him, I wanted to know how the Yankees did that day against Cleveland. You see, the Yankees, even though they were leading the American League by 10 games, they still hadn't clinched. And Roger was sitting on 55 home runs. So I kind of spoke around the rabbi. There were two gentlemen who were working in his office, and I said, anybody know how the Yankees did today? And one of the guys shouted out, yeah, the Yankees won 8-7 over Cleveland. Maris hit his 56th home run off of Jim Grant. I looked back at the rabbi and flatly said, no, I'm done. <laughs> 1961 was also an important year for me because it was the last year that my parents put the restriction on me that if I went to a Yankee game, I had to go with a chaperone. Now, let me explain what that means. First of all, I only went to 4 Yankee games. And for a 1 o'clock game, I'd get there about 15 minutes before the game started. And as soon as the game was over, we leave. 1962, I'm 14 years old. No chaperone restriction whatsoever. Instead of going to 4 Yankee games, I went to 40 Yankee games. 4-0. And instead of getting there 15 minutes before the 1 o'clock game, I'd get to Yankee Stadium at 8:30 in the morning. I know you're wondering, what is he doing at Yankee Stadium at 8:30? Let me explain. The Yankees would park their car across the street from Yankee Stadium. Once they got out, I felt it was my responsibility to walk the Yankees back across the street to Yankee Stadium. I mean, honestly, how else were they going to find Yankee Stadium if it wasn't for me? In reality, though, what I wanted is I wanted to talk to Roger Maris. But I never could get up enough nerve. I was just too nervous. Finally, I figured out the only way that I'm going to be able to communicate with him is if I write him a note. So I would. I'd write a note based on whatever happened the day before. Whether he hit a home run or struck out, I always wrote something positive. You're a great player. Go get him. And I'd always acknowledge that he's my favorite player and sign it. Well, after 2 or 3 times, Roger kind of looked for it. When he parked his car and all the kids got around him for an autograph, He would actually reach over the kids for my note. He'd take it, put it in his pocket, and walk into the ballpark. The gates open up at 11 a.m. I'd run out to the right field seating area. Now it was batting practice. And what I was hoping for was to get a batting practice baseball. At one point, one of my buddies said, "Why don't you ask Maris for a batting practice baseball?" So I got up enough nerve and I asked him. To my shock and astonishment, he flipped me a batting practice baseball. I couldn't move my left hand or my right hand. The ball hit me here, rolled away, and another kid got it. Roger is now running in to take batting practice. And remember the kid who was shy, who couldn't speak to Maris? All of a sudden I go, "Raj! Raj, I didn't get the ball!" He hears me, stops. He then talks to Phil Lins, utility infielder for the Yankees. Lins comes walking out to the right field stands, comes up to exactly where I am, and he says to me, "Hold out your hand." He puts a ball in my hand. I turn to my buddies and I said, "Look, I got a baseball from Roger Maris." And my buddy said, "No, you didn't, Dandy. We just saw it with our own eyes. You got a baseball not from Roger Maris, but from Phil Lins." Well, a couple of years later, I asked Roger Maris for the ultimate collectible. I asked him for a home run baseball and one of his bats. He told me, as far as the baseball was concerned, the home run baseball, I'd have to catch it. But the bat, he said, "The next time I crack one of my bats, I will give it to you." Well, the Yankees go on the road. They're actually playing in California against the Angels. It's 8:30 at night in California. It's 11:30 in New York. I'm in my room. The lights are out. I'm underneath the covers. My parents think I'm asleep. I'm listening to my radio. And at one point, the announcer says, "And now here comes Roger Maris." Roger singled in the first inning. Maris is batting 261. The big right-hander of the Angels looks in for the sign. He's got it. He checks the runner leading off first. Around comes the right arm. In comes the pitch. Maris swings and fouls it back into the upper deck behind home plate. Well, Maris must have cracked his bat because he's going to the dugout for a new piece of lumber. The next day, my best friend Gary Baker calls me and he says, "Andy, did you hear the Yankee game?" I said, "Yeah, Yankees won 6-2. He said, "No, Maris cracked his bat." "That's your bat." Well, the Yankees come in off the road trip. I get to Yankee Stadium and Maris's car is already parked. He's in the ballpark. I've got to wait until the gates open at 11 a.m. Once they do, I run out to the right field seating area. Now here comes Roger Maris. And instead of stopping and shagging some fly balls, he comes up to the fence and he says, "I've got that bat for you. Just before the start of the game, come to the dugout and I'll give it to you." He remembered! I ran to the dugout. I mean, I can't believe this is actually happening. As luck would have it, there's a security guard who is standing there watching over the dugout. He's about 7 feet tall, 400 pounds. With as much sincerity as I possibly can muster, I say, "Hi, my name is Andy Strasberg, good friend of Roger Maris's. He promised that he's got something for me. You've got to believe me. I've got to wait here. He'll be here any minute." The security guard says, "Hey, settle down, kid. Just stay right here. You're fine. I'm sure Maris will be here in just a few minutes." Well, within a couple of minutes, here comes Roger Maris walking through the Yankee dugout with my bat. This is the greatest day of my life. The confirmation of a promise from my childhood hero. This is the first time in my life that I don't want to stay for the Yankee game. I want to go home with my authentic, game-used Roger Maris bat. This bat. So it's a couple of years later, and I'm going to college. I'm at Akron University. I'm studying English literature, which for whatever reason was a surprise to my parents. And I can't understand why. I mean, I love to read, especially the classics, such as Lucky to Be a Yankee by Joe DiMaggio. The Mickey Mantle Story by Mickey Mantle as told to Ben Epstein, and Roger Maris at Bat by Jim Ogle. Well, I am living in the dorm, and I've got this poster of Roger Maris on my wall. Now, my roommate, and to this day, I still don't know what was going on in his mind, my roommate had a poster over his bed of Raquel Welch from 1 Million B.C. You know, the one where she's not wearing too much and kind of tilted on her side? You know what I'm talking about? That's it. That's the one. Well, I'm telling everybody at school that I am good friends with Roger Maris. That winter, Maris gets traded from the Yankees to the St. Louis Cardinals. I can't believe it. My guy is gone. He's not even in the American League anymore. I'm not going to see him play at Yankee Stadium. I'm having so much trouble with this. The 1967 season starts, and one of my buddies comes up, and he says, Andy, I happen to notice on the schedule that the St. Louis Cardinals are playing the Pittsburgh Pirates in Forbes Field. Why don't we travel over to Forbes Field, and you can introduce us to your good friend, Roger Maris? Naturally, I said, sure. Yeah, that's a great idea. Let's do that. Well, from Akron to Pittsburgh, it's about a two and a half hour drive. And I'm as nervous as can be. Maris has never seen me other than at Yankee Stadium. We get to Forbes Field, and it's about 20 minutes before the game. And I see Roger is warming up in front of the Cardinal dugout. I can tell by his red number 9. I go up to the edge of the fence. I got my buddies behind me. And I try to get his attention. I go, Raj? He turns around and looks at me and he says, Andy Strasberg, what the hell are you doing here in Pittsburgh?
Well, Raj, some of the guys from college wanted to meet you.
They lined up as if it was a wedding reception. Roger Maris, Jeff Sachs. Jeff Sachs, Roger Maris. Well, the game is about to begin after the introductions, and I am on cloud 9. Now I'm going to go out and sit in my seat. Now, like a lot of baseball fans, I am very superstitious. And for me, the superstition is the number 9. I go out to the right field seating area. Now, Maris's number is 9. He plays right field, and if you score in baseball, right field is the number 9. I go out and I sit in row 9, seat 9, and it's May 9th. In the 6th inning, Roger gets up against Woody Freeman. He had struck out in his first at bat. The Cardinals are winning by a score of 2-1. The count goes to 2-2, and Woody Freeman tries to throw a curveball by Maris. Roger swings and hits his first National League home run. I caught the ball. I don't move. The only thing that I felt besides disbelief are the warm tears of joy coming down my cheeks. My buddies are hooting and hollering, slapping me on the back. At the end of the inning, Roger comes out to the edge of the fence, looks up at me and says, I don't believe it. He said, I don't believe it either. Next year is 1968, and in the beginning of the year, Roger announces that he is going to retire at the conclusion of the season. His career in baseball will be over. My parents asked me, what do I want for my birthday? And I explained, I would like to see Roger Maris play his very last regular season game. So I fly to St. Louis to see the Friday, Saturday, and Sunday game. On Friday night, I look for his wife, Pat Maris. I go up to her, and I introduce myself and explain who I am. Sunday's game. It's the eighth inning, and Red Shingdinks, the Cardinal manager, steps out of the dugout and signals that he wants to replace Roger Maris in the outfield. What he really wants to do is give the fans the opportunity to give Roger Maris another standing ovation. I'm sitting behind the dugout, and as Roger is running off the field, I'm thinking, so is my childhood. I'm 20 years old. I figure eventually I'm going to figure out how to graduate from college, get a job, and get on with my life. Roger waves to everybody and ducks into the dugout. I didn't think he saw me. And then he pops his head out, looks at me, winks, and goes back into the dugout. I'm thinking, this is the most perfect ending that anyone could imagine. And I should point out that there was this great article in the Sporting News the week after he retired, October 12, 1968. And in the article, Maris talks about how much he appreciated me coming from New York to see him play his final game. And he also talks about how Andy Strasberg is his most faithful and loyal fan. There it is, in print, and it's a quote from Roger Maris. Well, we keep in touch over the years through cards and letters. 1975, I get my job with the Padres. The first people I contact are my parents. The second person I contact is my girlfriend, Patty, who would later become my wife. And the third person that I contact is Roger Maris. Now I'm a baseball executive. It's 1978, and I'm attending the winter baseball meetings. That's where all baseball executives from all the teams get together and go over some of the problems and hopefully some of the solutions to those problems. The winter meetings is taking place in Hollywood, Florida, and Maris had retired to Gainesville, Florida. I'm sitting in a big conference room, and at one point, with a bunch of other baseball executives, and at one point, somebody taps me on the shoulder and says, there's a guy out in the hallway, he'd like to see you. I'm thinking in the back of my head, could it be? I go out into the hallway, and it is. It's Roger Maris. Had not seen him in 10 years. God, it's great to see you, Raj. You have got to meet my wife, Patty. He said, great, I'll do it. I'll be sitting over there. Why don't you go and get her? And over there meant there was this big table, and sitting there was Whitey Herzog, Mo Drabowski, and New York Daily News baseball columnist Dick Young. Well, I go out to the pool area, I find Patty, and I said, you're not going to believe it. Roger Maris is here, and you're going to get to meet him. And Patty said, well, I can't go like this. I've got to do my hair, I've got to put on makeup, I've got to wear something presentable. So Patty goes upstairs, I go back in, and now I'm standing behind Roger. He's talking to these guys, and he can't see me. And I'm waiting for a pause in the conversation so I can tell him that Patty's on her way. And I'm listening to him, and I hear him talk about this kid who was his fan when he played for the New York Yankees, this kid who he became friends with, and how this kid is now working for the San Diego Padres, and how proud he is of this kid. I'm thinking, not only did I get to meet my childhood hero, not only did we become friends, but he's proud of me? That night, we went out to dinner. Roger, his wife Pat, Patty and I, and it was great. The conversation was spectacular. There were a number of social occasions over the next few years that we got together, each one was better than the other one. December of 1985, a flash comes on the television. It announces that Roger Maris, at 51 years old, had passed away from cancer. I immediately got up, went to the phone, made plane reservations. I was going to fly to Fargo, North Dakota, Roger's childhood hometown, where the funeral service would take place. I left San Diego. It was 78 degrees. In the middle of December, I land in Fargo, North Dakota, and it's 10 below. I go to the church where the funeral service is, and I decide to hold back. What I wanted to do was wait for everybody to go up and pay their condolences to the Maris family. Once I saw the last person go up, I then went up, and as soon as Pat Maris saw me, she gave me a hug, and she thanked me for coming. And then she said to me, "Andy, have you ever met the kids? Roger and Pat have 6 children, all adults at this time." I told her no, and she turned to the kids and she said, "Kids, I want to introduce you to somebody very special. This is Andy Strasberg." And Roger Maris Jr. said, "I know you. You're Dad's number one fan." Well, the only thing that I could say is, you'll never know how much your dad meant to me growing up. And Roger Maris Jr. didn't miss a beat. He said, "You'll never know how much he meant to our dad." Well, I got very emotional. I was a little bit embarrassed. I excused myself. The next day, I sought out the family to apologize. And that's what I did. I told them that I hope someday we are able to meet under better circumstances. That was December of 1985. June of 1986, the Maris family had a special dinner to honor the memory of Roger Maris in Fargo. 700 people attended. The speakers at that dinner were family, friends, and teammates. And one guy representing the fans. And I was that guy. I got to stand up in front of all those people, and I got to share the story that I've told you here tonight. And when I was done, I told everybody at that dinner I had a very special video music tribute to my hero, Roger Maris. And I said, before I play it, I want to explain a couple of things. First of all, the little boy that you see in this video, that's me growing up. And the very first picture that you see needs a little bit of an explanation. I was 12 years old in that picture. And I wanted to see if I was ever lucky enough, if I could have my picture taken with Roger Maris, what would it look like? So what I did is I got a magazine with a picture of Roger in it. I went into one of those booths, you know, 4 photos for a corner, and had my picture taken. Folks, this is the 1986 video I showed at that dinner.
Roger Maris, 61 home runs, an unprecedented achievement. How about that?
The video ends, the lights go up, and the Maris family comes over and gives me a group hug. There was a reception after the dinner that night, and it was for the people who were at the head table as well as some of the speakers. I had the opportunity to speak to all the members of the Maris family. At one point, I'm talking to Roger's son, Randy Maris, and I'm starting to think that maybe we're connecting. And I'm wondering, could it be possible that the relationship that I had with Randy's dad, Roger, could be transferred through Randy? Is it possible that we're going to be friends? And the answer was yes, very good friends. So much so that Randy and his wife, Fran, would come to San Diego and vacation with Patty and me. Patty and I would go to Florida, where they live, and we'd vacation with them. We took a cruise together and one very memorable car trip. Now, everything I've mentioned tonight, there's been a lot of words that describe it. For me, those words include memorable, amazing, remarkable, incredible, and sentimental. But there's one word that is very, very important to me, and that's the word true. And the reason that I mention that to you now is because on August 3rd, 1990, I got a call from Fran and Randy Maris. They called me from a hospital in Gainesville, Florida, to tell me that Fran had just given birth to a baby boy. They were going to name him Andrew. Never in my wildest dreams did I ever imagine that my childhood hero's grandson would be my namesake. After the Padres' 1996 season, I was no longer employed by the ball club. New ownership. New ownership. All right. I opened up my own marketing consulting business in 1997. And then one day in the year 2000, I went in and listened to all the voicemail messages that I had. And one of them said, "Hi, this is Ross Greenberg. I'm with HBO. When you get a chance, give me a call back." And he left a 212 area code. Well, I called Ross back, not knowing that Ross Greenberg at the time was the president of HBO Sports. When I got him on the phone, the first thing he said to me is, "Andy, do you have any idea why I'm calling you?" Well, being a smartass, I said, "Yeah, Ross, I figured it out. You're with HBO. You want me to try HBO for free for 30 days. If I like it, you want me to subscribe." Fortunately for me, he laughed and he said, "No, Andy, we just hired Billy Crystal. We're going to do a movie. It's called 61, and it's about that summer that Mantle and Maris chased Babe Ruth's single-season home run record. Andy, we'd like to hire you as a technical consultant." Well, I was floored. I said, "Absolutely. If I have the blessings of the Maris family, the answer is yes." Well, Pat Maris said, "Okay," and I was on board. Working with Billy Crystal day in and day out for this movie, I mean, the combination was so incredible. It was the movie process, the subject of the movie, it was Billy Crystal. And remember, Billy and I are the exact same age. He was born in March of 48. He was a Mickey guy. I'm a Roger guy. We got to go to places during that we only dreamt about it as 13-year-olds. I mean, for us, it was time travel. We got to go to the clubhouse in 1961, on the field, Roger and Mickey's apartment, in the bars. I mean, it was just one great experience after another. There was one time we were filming in Detroit at Tiger Stadium, the real Tiger Stadium. I came walking on the set. Billy grabs my arm as soon as he saw me, and he says, "You're not going to believe this. Come with me." He walks me over to the visiting dugout, and he shows me the bathroom. He points to the urinal, and he says, do you have any idea the guys who've taken a piss here? Ruth, Garrick, DiMaggio, Ted Williams, Mantle, Maris, even Hank Aaron. In the middle of the filming, and remember, I was only hired as a technical consultant. In the middle of the filming, Billy comes to me and he says, so Andy, you want a cameo in the movie? Yeah! He said, Andy, how would you like to be an umpire? Not interested, Billy. Well, the look on his face, he was confused, he didn't understand. I said, Billy, I need to explain to you. Do you happen to have a video of the newsreel of when Maris hit his 61st home run? Billy says, yeah, I've got it in my trailer. And I said, let's go take a look and I'll explain it to you. So we go to his trailer and he starts playing the video. I said, Billy, I will never ever forget when Maris circled the bases after he hit his 61st home run, he's about to come to home plate. And at home plate, the next batter is Yogi Berra and the bat boy, Frankie Prudente. But before Maris gets to the dugout, one fan very politely comes out to shake his hand and pat him on the back. Billy, I was 13 years old and I wanted to be that fan. Now I'm in my 50s, I still want to be that fan. Billy said, okay, Andy, you can be that fan. Oh, look, here's a clip from my movie, 61.
Here's the wind-up.
Everybody get ready. If anybody's thinking of blinking, do it now.
How about that?
He ran that out just like it was his first.
Here we go. Hold your breath. My friend Dwayne put this together for me and surprised me with this montage of what really happened and what happened in the movie. I like this more than I like the movie. The reason being, I'm on the screen a lot longer here than I was in the movie. So, Patty and I go to Hollywood for the screening of this movie. What a great experience that was. Very, very unique. Well, the movie ends and the credits start rolling. And the applause does not die down. It just keeps going on and on and on. And I'm trying to figure out why they keep applauding. Well, they kept applauding because everybody listed in the credits is in the audience. I knew that Billy was going to list me as a technical consultant. What I didn't know what Billy was going to do. As a result of his sensitivity, his kindness, and his generosity, Billy also listed me as an actor. This is a movie. This is reality. Baseball Did you know it had 108 stitches? It's been called a pill, a pearl, an apple, Mr. Spaulding, old horse-eyed, and Pelota. It seems like all my life I've been gripping a baseball, when in reality, baseball's been gripping me.